This video is brought to you by BougeRV. It's been nice to see the growing popularity of electric vehicles these last few years, but EVs need batteries, and batteries don't last forever. In fact, the first generation of EV batteries are already dying, and there's an absolute dead battery typhoon coming. Lithium battery recycling is improving, but it's still far from where we need it to be, at least throughput-wise. Luckily, there's another option that's pretty simple. Just take those used batteries and repurpose them for less demanding, large-scale energy storage. That's exactly what's happening at a recently opened 25 megawatt hour grid scale energy storage system in California. But if these batteries are dead, how are they able to bring new life to renewable energy storage? I'm Matt Ferrell. Welcome to Undecided. If you can get quality grid scale energy storage from just daisy chaining a bunch of car batteries together, then why aren't they everywhere? And why would someone string 1300 dead car batteries together in the first place? Well, the reason might surprise you, but this weird solution will make sense in just a minute. California is famously sunny and warm, and to beat the heat, many Californians rely on air conditioning. As you might expect, this leads to a significant power draw during the day, which isn't a huge problem, as that's when renewables are generally most productive. But the draw actually climbs even higher at night when people return to their homes, which is unfortunately right when renewables like solar start to fall off. So how does the most populous US state handle these massive energy swings? Well, right now, the answer is peaker plants, whose purpose, as you can probably guess from their name, is to supply not quite emergency power during these peak times. So great, problem solved, right? Not quite, because peaker plants get their power from natural gas. To be clear, natural gas isn't as bad as oil or coal, but it's still a fossil fuel that gets burned and puts carbon into the atmosphere. And to quote California Energy Commission Chair Dan Hochschild, peaker power plants are the most expensive, least efficient, and most polluting part of our fleet. So obviously it would be great if we could switch to renewables, but that brings us to the next problem, and one that viewers of my channel will be very familiar with, and that's effective energy storage. It's why I'm obsessed with this topic. Luckily, electric vehicles are helping with decarbonization just in their own way. They've been with us for years now and are becoming increasingly affordable and popular. For perspective, back in 2012, just 120,000 electric cars were sold worldwide. In 2021, more than that are sold each week. Unfortunately, all these cars are powered by batteries that will need to be replaced eventually. So what the heck are we going to do with all those batteries? Well, reduce, reuse, recycle, right? We don't want to see a reduction in electric cars and their batteries for plenty of reasons, so let's not reduce there. Lithium battery recycling has made some great strides recently with groups like Redwood Materials, Recyclico, and Li-Cycle working hard to make the process easier and more efficient. But the coming flood of used batteries, or battery flood, which is coincidentally the name of my new metal band, is a challenge too big for recycling to handle alone. That leaves us with the reuse. But how can we reuse dead car batteries? And this brings us back to BTU Storage Solutions and their seemingly super simple answer to all these issues. They've taken approximately 1,300 used Nissan and Honda batteries and strung them together to form the SEPV Sierra Hybrid Solar Storage Facility. Based in Lancaster, California, this 25 megawatt hour facility is likely the largest fully operational second life battery storage facility on the planet. But if these old EV batteries are dead, how does this even work? Has BTU discovered some sort of battery necromancy? Actually, battery necromancy is the name of my new metal band. Battery necromancy. Nope, it's way simpler than that. Before we get into this interesting approach to battery storage, there's another bit of tech that you can use to pair with battery storage for yourself today, and that's from today's sponsor, BougeRV. I've talked about portable and modular batteries that are perfect for your on-the-go power backup and use, but pairing those batteries with solar takes things to a whole new level. The problem with most portable solar panels, though, is that they're large, heavy, and can be fragile. BougeRV's 100-watt PASO SIG solar panel, and SIG stands for copper, indium, gallium, and selenide, it solves those problems because it folds down to something that can fit in a laptop-sized carry bag, and they're virtually unbreakable and will still perform really well after a crash. Monopanels, on the other hand, are easily broken, so in similar situations you might have to replace them every few years. Now, using and installing them couldn't be easier. Just open the pack and unfold. There are four holes so that you can tie it down to any hanger or just lay it flat on a surface. If you like camping or like traveling around in an RV, this is a great addition to any battery storage. Even if you don't go camping a lot, this is a great addition for emergency battery backup at home. You can top up your portable battery if the grid is down to keep things going even longer. If you want to permanently attach a solar panel to a curved surface like a boat deck or Airstream, check out the BougeRV Yuma 200-watt flexible solar panel. If you want an incredibly flexible, durable, and waterproof solar panel that can go just about anywhere, check out the link in the description, and thanks again to BougeRV and to all of you for supporting the channel. Now back to BTU's simple approach. If you own a rechargeable device, and I'm willing to bet that you do, you're well aware that their ability to hold a charge diminishes over time. The reasons for this are a little complicated, but for more information, you can check out some of the other videos I've done on batteries that are linked down below. But suffice to say, lithium-ion batteries remain the gold standard in consumer goods, especially in EVs, and that's for very good reasons. This includes their solid capacity and longevity, their good energy-to-weight ratio, power density, swift charge and discharge times, affordability, reliability, you get the idea. But life for a lithium-ion battery in an EV is pretty demanding. And once a battery starts to go, usually when it's only around 70 to 80% of its original capacity, it can no longer live up to those standards and needs to be replaced. But hey, a battery's life doesn't end around 80%, there's still plenty of good times left in its golden years, just maybe not inside a brand new Tesla. Stationary intermittent renewable storage is actually a great home for aging batteries, because in this application, they're allowed to charge and release energy more slowly, and the cycling needs and other demands are generally less intense than in a high-performance vehicle. But their efficiency, reliability, and safety are still appreciated. This is backed up by a 2019 McKinsey Sustainability Report, which found that even after 10 years, an EV battery can be reused in markets that need stationary energy storage with less frequent cycling. Again, back to BTU, who saw this coming battery apocalypse. Okay, no, that's the name of my metal band. Anyway, BTU put two and two together and voila, turned these mountains of EV batteries into grid-scale storage facilities. So I know I said the solution was simple, but it's not quite as easy as hooking up a bunch of old car batteries to some solar panels in the desert. There's some unresolved challenges to this, which we'll get into in a minute, but more challenges have been solved than not. One such challenge is the batteries themselves. With 1,300 batteries, all of them different ages, from different makes and models of car, in different states of degradation, there's a lot of variables that you have to manage, especially since we have literal tons of batteries working in sequence, and we don't want the older or weaker ones to slow down the system. There's also some safety concerns. Lithium batteries are notoriously, if actually very rarely, susceptible to overheating, leading to dramatic cases of thermal runaway. Now, stacking a bunch of these batteries together in parallel strings in an especially warm and sunny state might sound like a disaster waiting to happen. Now, it's here that BTU's biggest innovation comes into the picture. Their software, in tandem with their cabinet controllers, monitors all those battery variables during charge and discharge cycles. It can connect and disconnect the batteries as needed, allowing the older batteries to take a break before they drag down the performance of their buddies. BTU CEO Freeman Hall claims that this approach enables our system to achieve efficient energy yield despite the variance in capacity inherent in second life batteries. On the safety front, BTU's EPS cabinet controllers monitor the health of the individual batteries and flag situations where there are potential problems that can affect future performance. The operators can also set strict safety parameters, and if the battery deviates from these guardrails, the pack is automatically disconnected, allowing it to cool down and to be dealt with rather than risking any kind of disaster. Now this brings us to another innovation from BTU. Lithium car batteries are usually made up of thousands of roughly AA-sized batteries, literally glued together. There are close to 7,000 of them for a Tesla. Part of the reason it can be challenging to recycle or repurpose these batteries is because you normally have to break apart a pack to get to the individual cells. But that's not the case for the Sierra facility. Their cabinets are designed to accept packs as they are, instead of having to jailbreak each individual cell, which saves them time and money, and allows replacement batteries to easily be tagged in when their time comes. Combined with their cabinet controllers and software designed to translate commands across different battery makes, it means they've made the process of reusing batteries and grid-scale storage much cheaper, an estimated 40% cheaper. Hall claims it costs less than $200 per kilowatt hour to install, which is well below the norm for lithium-ion battery storage plants. For context, a National Renewable Energy Lab study put the cost for a similar facility in 2023 at around $283 per kilowatt hour. And they didn't project costs to dip below that $200 per kilowatt hour until 2030. And speaking of money, the EPS controller doesn't just monitor the batteries, it monitors the market for the best deals too. By taking advantage of both predictable daily price shifts and unexpected price hikes, it automates bids and sends them directly to the California grid. Tesla has similar functionality with their Megapack installations. Essentially, it collects energy when the sun is shining, and collecting that power is cheap. And then when people get home at night, it sells the energy to the grid when it's the most desired and valuable. It's a sort of buy low, sell high arbitrage strategy that has generated over $1 million in revenue for BTU in 2022. The fact they've already proven themselves financially successful probably makes them even more appealing to investors and lawmakers, which hopefully means more plants like this in the future. The SEPV plant has already proven that it's an affordable, reliable, and effective grid scale storage solution for solar energy. It offers a home for older batteries and seems ready and able to start replacing those gas burning peaker plants. That all sounds incredible, so what's the catch? There's always a catch, and yes, we alluded to it earlier, some challenges do remain. BTU is mostly working with Nissan and Honda, so their system is largely designed around dimensions and shapes that work with those. If the batteries deviate from the standard shape, it might diminish some of the benefits of BTU's plug-and-play system. Although at least on the software side, tests of the Chevy Bolt and the Tesla Model 3 show that the EPS system can communicate with just about any EV battery model. Ironically, the biggest issue is that the system is small. 25 megawatt hours of storage is a great start, but for context, peaker plants like the Hannaford and Henrietta plants have 95 megawatt capacities each, and I know that's megawatts, not megawatt hours, but you can kind of see the scale there. If that battery plant was running at 100 megawatts, it would last for 15 minutes. We're gonna need a lot more and bigger SEPV storage facilities and accompanying renewable power plants if we wanna dump those polluting peaker plants. But all in all, these are some pretty minor hurdles to jump. Ultimately, BTU's Sierra SEPV facility shows that we don't have to wait for the next big battery paradigm shift to up our renewable energy storage game. The technology is already here. It's safe, it works well, and it's relatively inexpensive. As EVs become more popular and age, there's going to be no shortage of supplies. Plus, it's not like the sun is going anywhere for another 5 billion years either. Speaking of which, BTU's setup isn't limited to solar storage. There's a lot of wind power in California, Texas, and other states that could really benefit from a solution just like this. Hopefully, we'll see more plants like this sooner rather than later. So what do you think? Jump in the comments and let me know. Be sure to check out my follow-up podcast, Still To Be Determined, where we'll be discussing some of your feedback. And thanks to all my patrons who get ad-free versions of every video, and thanks to all of you for watching. I'll see you in the next one.